In the preceding videos, we discussed some important concepts for thin film solar cells. In this section, we will discuss the most important deposition techniques used for the deposition of thin film solar cells. We start this section with this video on the interconnection of thin film solar cells. The learning objectives for this video are to understand how and why the interconnection of thin film solar cells are different from wafer-based solar cells. We will discuss how the series connections between thin film solar cells are established, and we will look into the main challenges associated with these interconnections. Making thin film modules is very different from making modules from wafer-based crystalline silicon solar cells. The fabrication of modules with crystalline silicon technology involves two distinct steps. In the first step, crystalline silicon solar cells, like the one shown here, are produced. In the second step, the cells are used to create a module. This involves connecting several of these wafer-based solar cells. The back contact of one cell is connected to the front contact of the next to create a series connection. In thin film technology, producing cells and modules cannot be separated from each other. To fabricate a thin film module, a transparent front contact, a stack of photoactive layers, and a back contact are deposited onto each other. In industrial production, the glass plates onto which these layers are deposited can be very large, with size significantly exceeding 1 by 1 square meters. Such a stack of layers basically forms one very large solar cell that will produce a very high current. Since all the current would have to be transported across the front and back contacts, which are very thin, a relatively large fraction of the power would be lost due to resistive losses. Therefore, the module is produced such that it consists of many very narrow cells of about 0.5 to 1 centimeter width, depending on the PV technology, as can be seen in this figure. The length of these narrow cells is equal to the module length. The cells are connected in series across the width. On the very left and right of the module, metallic bus bars will be present to collect the current and conduct it to the bottom of the module, where they are connected with external cables. The series connection of the thin film modules is established with laser scribing. In general, a total of 3 laser scribes are required to separate 2 cells from each other. To illustrate these laser scribing steps, we will look at this thin film cell deposited in superstrate configuration. On top of a glass substrate, the transparent front electrode is deposited. Then, the first laser scribe is performed, called P1. The wavelength of the laser is such that it is transmitted through the glass and absorbed by the front contact. The P1 laser scribing step evaporates the material and leaves a gap in the front contact. Then, the photoactive layers are deposited on top of the front contact, creating a thin film and filling the gap left by the first laser scribe. After deposition of the absorber layer, the second laser scribe, called P2, is performed. The wavelength of the laser has to be chosen such that it is not absorbed by the glass and transparent front contact, but in the absorber layer. For example, in the case of an amorphous silicon absorber layer, green laser light can be used. The P2 laser scribe leaves a gap in the absorber layer. This gap is filled with the deposition of the final layer, which is the metallic back contact. Then the third laser scribe, called P3, is performed. The wavelength of this laser scribe has to be chosen such that it is transmitted through all of the preceding layers and is only absorbed by the back contact. It may therefore be, for instance, infrared light. The final laser scribe evaporates the metal and creates a gap in the back contact. So, How exactly do these laser scribes create a series connection? The P1 laser scribe interrupts the front electrode and is filled with the absorber material. The absorber material is orders of magnitude less conductive than the front electrode, and the width of the laser scribe is an order of magnitude larger than the thickness of the absorber layer in the growth direction. Therefore, the absorber material forms a barrier against lateral charge carrier movement. Similarly, the P3 scribes form an insulating gap in the metallic back contact. The P2 scribe, however, that is also filled with a metal, forms a highly conduction connection between the front and back contacts. If we zoom out, we can see how the current flows through the P2 scribe and connects the individual cells in series. The area in which the laser scribes take place is called the interconnect width. The cell width is defined by the P3 and P1 scribes. If we look, for example, at this CIGS-based PV module deposited in substrate configuration. CIGS-based technologies will be discussed extensively later in this course. The molybdenum back contact is deposited first on top of the glass substrate. After the P1 laser scribe creates gaps in the back contact, the CIGS p-dope layer is deposited. The deposition of the CIGS absorber is followed by the P2 laser scribe and the deposition of the cadmium sulfide n-doped layer. The front TCO is deposited last, which consists of an intrinsic zinc oxide layer and an n-type aluminium doped zinc oxide layer. This figure shows what such a single CIGS solar cell looks like. For illustrative purposes, the colors are added to this figure. Finally, the P3 laser scribe is performed. Now, the front TCO electrode is connected with the molybdenum back contact of the next solar cell. The performance of such an interconnect established via laser scribes, and hence the total module performance, is determined by several things. First, the P2 scribe must be highly conductive. This means that the scribe has to be wide enough and that there should be no barrier at the interface between the front contact and the metal back contact. The P1 and P3 scribes, on the other hand, must form good barriers to effectively separate the cells from each other. Finally, the region between the P1 and P3 scribes does not contribute to the current generated by the module. This area therefore subtracts from the active area of the cell. Naturally, the active area with respect to the total area should be as large as possible in order to maximize the PV module performance. Other issues are more practical of nature, such as the fact that laser scribes are performed in different steps of production and thus often with different machines. Further, the distance between the scribes might be different at different processes when they are performed at different temperatures. Aligning the glass plates in the production steps is extremely important for manufacturing high-quality thin film modules. In summary, we discussed how producing thin film modules is very different from producing wafer-based crystalline silicon modules. The production of crystalline silicon modules consists of two distinct steps: the production of cells and connecting several cells into a module. For thin film modules, laser scribes are used to create a series of small cells from what is effectively one very large solar cell. We looked into the various deposition steps and laser scribes involved in the fabrication of a thin film module, and we discussed the main challenges associated with this process. In the next video, we will look into some of the deposition techniques used.